as long as there have been politicians, there have been satirists lampooning them. And my next guest, impressionist Rory Bremner, is Britain's most famous political comedian, and he's joining me now right here. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
What do you make of it? Is this comedy fodder for you?
Well, it is. It's partly trying to make sense of it at all, because I'm sure around
like
the world...
Everybody.
Yes, exactly. Trying to work out what exactly is going on, because I think Natalie Bennett was talking about our first past the post system. It's now moving to a second past the post system, because according to the bookmakers, they're saying that the favourites to get more seats are the Conservatives. So you think, well, they'll form the government. No, the favourite to get into government is actually the Labour Party. And I think this is a part... This is multi-party politics. This is the thing, because I go back to 1951, and 96% of the voters voted either Labour or Conservative. But now there's all this choice. And I think one of the consequences of David Cameron saying, I don't want to debate with the other one, is we've seen all the other parties and we've seen all these different political flavours. And it's rather difficult to get seven parties through a two-party system. And I think the electorate, we also like to keep the politicians guessing. So we're a week away and 40% apparently...
It's really extraordinary. 40% is extraordinary. You slip in and out of Cameronisms and others very naturally. But are these... Is this crop... The seven who we saw on the stage at the first debate, in fact, we watched it together. Are they satirizable? Are they comic fodder?
Well, yes, I mean, caricatures. Partly now the public has seen them. They've seen them in these debates. I mean, Cameron, we've been watching for quite a while, and he's got that sort of patrician thing. I mean, people say, oh, am I going to make the rich richer or the poor poorer? I think we can do both. I think that's what. Miliband has had an interesting campaign because he started off, people sort of caricatured him as being quite geeky and they have that kind of way of speaking as a child. I swallowed a kazoo, and people actually said, you know, they characterised people like animals. They said that Cameron was a fox and Farage was a weasel or a peacock. And actually, the public said that this is true. That Miliband, they said, if you went to the zoo and you didn't see that animal there, you wouldn't be bothered. But he's actually done well during this campaign. I think he's actually matured, and people have seen a sort of, there's a stillness and a focus and an intensity, which reminds me a little bit of Barack Obama. He has something of that intellectual aloofness about him. Nigel Farage, of course, as we've seen, great achievement. He's managed to take UKIP from being a lunatic fringe party to becoming, you know, a lunatic mainstream party. I think, you know, that's not nothing. The other ones, you know, this is the big phenomenon, of course, has been the SNP. In fact, the election in many ways will
Can
be decided.
Can you do Nicola Sturgeon?
I wouldn't dare, because it is illegal in Scotland to do this is a thing. Actually,
what?
did you know this? It says... Oh, I can't believe you went for that. No, during the referendum campaign, if you made fun of Alex Salmond, you got into terrible trouble. People say, don't insult me because I voted for him, which is very bizarre because, you know, all my life I've been doing political figures, whether it's Gordon Brown or Tony Blair. And, you know, where's Tony Blair now? Well, Middle East peace
well,
envoy.
Well, where...
And to be fair, the Middle East has never been more peaceful.
More peaceful,
I mean,
indeed.
Anyway, yeah, I mean, look at Libya.
Anybody can tell you that.
Yeah.
Do you miss the big characters? I mean, you know, there was a lot of spitting image. There were all these amazing things that you were involved in. And there were huge, whatever you thought of them, larger-than-life people like Reagan or Thatcher.
Yeah. Or indeed, yeah, well, satire does, in fact, it thrives on grotesques in a way. But also that was a time when politics kind of, or the politicians, it seemed like they were big beasts and they were bigger than the whole game. And now it's much more complicated because, you know, how much power do politicians actually have? It's more subtle. It's, you know, you've got the big businesses, you've got the multinationals, you've got the banks and all that. So, and also during the last election, during the last 5 years, there were fewer characters. I think in some ways, if characters were eccentric, it was in a way a liability. We've got Boris Johnson, who you may be familiar, the mayor of London, yes. And he's rampantly eccentric. And in many ways, he's one of the most popular politicians we have. We like politicians, I think, to be recognisable, that we can relate to.
You say that, relate to, but one of the problems is that a lot of people are disconnected. There aren't that many political comedy shows that there used to be, even in my lifetime. I mean, 20 years ago, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That's the thing. Well, in a strange way, I think that satire shows, well, like America, of course, has The Daily Show, and a lot of people get their political information, their education from The Daily Show. We haven't had an equivalent weekly show running during the time of this coalition, so it hasn't been sort of held to account.
Should there be one?
Absolutely, because satire is not just about knocking the politicians down. It actually, if people watch a show like The Daily Show or ours as it was, they're getting to know their politicians, albeit in a comic context, and I think that's important.
Well, you know, as you said, it's not just about satire and comedy, it's about these very important things. And you just wrote an article where you highlighted some of the sort of straw men, so to speak, that a lot of politicians and people then start believing. Yeah. For instance, the public thinks that 24% of benefits are claimed fraudulently. Mm-hmm. The real figure is 0.7%.
Yeah.
That must bother you a lot.
Well, it does. I think part of the issue, I think outside Britain, people must look at this and say, well, you've got quite good economic figures, you've got growth and unemployment is down, you know, why isn't Cameron streets ahead? And I think it's because we are divided as a country. As I said, you know, about the rich have got richer, but the poor have got poorer. And there is this, and yet still, you know, Conservative, they are going past it. You know, are we going to tax rich people in their mansions or poor people who have a spare room that they only use when their daughter comes out of dialysis? Well, the Conservatives, they're taxing the poor people who have a spare room that they only use when their daughter comes out of dialysis. And I think the British people out there think there's an unfairness about that. I think they think that the hole was blown in the economy, £850 billion at the top end, and it's the bottom end that's suffering through austerity. So I think that's why it's a no-brainer. I think people are conflicted. They think, well, yes, the rich are doing very well, but what about the rest of the country? So we haven't made up our minds yet.
And as a comedian, you wear your politics on your sleeve as well. Do you vote Labour?
No, I've always been kind of to the left, I have to say. I've voted for...
Lefter than that.
Well, actually, yes, and Tony Blair, actually, the Labour wasn't that left. He realised he could move, you know, going back into the past, Christiane, but, you know, I could go as far right as I wanted, because in those days there was nothing to the left of Tony Blair, so he could almost overtake the Conservatives. Now, of course, Ed Miliband is calculating that the political centre in Britain is a little bit further to the left. And he's calling the bluff of the city, he's calling the bluff of the non-doms, and he's saying, well if you all leave the country... You know, you leave the country, but all I'm saying is, you know, pay your fair share. So,
And they're all watching overseas.
They're all,
They're looking in.
They're saying, well, the French are saying, you know, we've done this, it didn't work so well, and the Spanish and the Portuguese. But it is, there is a choice at this election. I think there is a choice. And interestingly, the city doesn't seem to be panicking. Everything seems to be, it's a very curious time to be in Britain, because if 40% haven't made their minds up yet, the politicians don't. Nobody knows what's going to happen.
And that's why it's so exciting.
Even the Queen. The Queen must be sort of saying, well, you know, I wish somebody would tell me, because so I'm going to have to ask somebody to form a government. And if they don't make up their minds, my week's going to be rather ruined.
Rory Bremner. On that note, the Queen has the last word.
Always.